My name is Mark Stops. I'm a technical director at a company called Lear, just north of Boston. Today, what I want to do is give you two things. One, I want to explain to you why it's so important that you have Sitecore personalization working for you today, not tomorrow, not next quarter, not next year. And two, I want to show you some of the tools and the new technology that's available to you to help you get that working for you. So what I'm going to do is explain a little bit about why now. Why it's so important that you have this personalization working. Then, I'm going to show you a demo. Just going to dive right in, let you see what it could be like for you to have some of these new tools working for you. After that, I'm going to break out, explain a little bit about the technology that you saw, and then most important, I'm going to put it into your hands so that you can try it yourself. After that, close up, ask some questions, and then we'll be done. So let's dive in. Time is money. Duh, Mark. Why are you telling me this? But what I mean by this is that every day that you don't have personalization working for you on your system, you're losing the money from competitors who do have it working. You're missing the audience that is drifting away towards them. Now, for the people who got personalization working early, who dove in, tried it out, kicked the tires, figured it out, taught their teams, built a competency, they have it working, kind of honed it, they're in a good position. But for the people who don't, you have a much higher hurdle now. The tools have only grown, and they've become more complex. Your hurdle that you have to clear to get into the game is higher now. And what I want to do is lower that hurdle for you, raise right now. Your content without personalization is hard to find. Maybe you have an aggregation, maybe you have a search. Maybe it's even pretty good. But a search is really only going to let you find that one thing that you're looking for. It's not going to help you make those connections to all the other things that you're likely offering to your audience. And that's what personalization is going to do. And unfortunately, when people come and they don't find things, they leave. They go to your competitors. They go to better experienced places. And you're going to hit kind of a plateau. And you're going to have stagnant conversion rates if you have goals enabled at all. And I'm a serious thing. So what I want to do is build this case for you so that you can go back and you have some information in your hands. I went and looked at a bunch of surveys and found some data. I'm going to give you some numbers, some actual value for your system. And one of the surveys that I found, the first thing I found was 46% of people have at least a basic level of personalization working for them. But that's less than half. 5% have a full customer view. That means they really know who their customers are. And 36%, even when they have the tools available to them, they couldn't get it working. Now that's me, that kills me. I'm an engineer and I solve problems and I love to see when people use that technology to their advantage. And when they can't, ugh. But 81% of the people surveyed found that this was the area that they're going to be competing in, and they know it. So we know that this is important. And less than half of us are in the game. And 5% are winning the game. That 5% are going to be slowly drawing off your audience, drawing off your value. On the other hand, if you can get into the game, there's a direct benefit to you. Now, another survey, 49% of buyers who were faced with a personalized experience, they impulse purchased. 85% of them were satisfied with that purchase. 40% of them paid more. And 44% of them became repeat buyers. This matters. Personalization is valuable. You need it. On the other hand, one of my coworkers was kind enough to do a review for me. She mentioned to me that most of our clients are nonprofits. But there is still a valid business case for them to also use personalization. If you're not doing commerce, what's the value for you? And I found some more information, 44% of people will donate up to 10% more for a personalized experience. If you hone that down to millennials, that number jumps to 62%. Paige O'Neill in the keynote, she was noting how millennials really care about this experience, and this data backs that up. Truth Initiative, name should be well aware of. They found that they got 3 times more conversion rate when they were doing personalized experience. The American Cancer Society saw a 34% increase in the donations when they were giving text messages with a personalized message. There's value here. Personalization works with commerce background or a nonprofit background. The thing is that creating personalized experiences can be a little challenging. The people who are creating personalized experiences also need a personalized experience. Now, Sitecore itself has a lot of tools available to it. It's a pretty sophisticated product, it's complex. There's a lot of ways that you can use it to be successful. The question really is, which way is the best way for you? And how do we take Sitecore and all its vastness and tailor it down to what you need? Build you some shortcuts. Get some of the things out of the way that you don't necessarily need and focus on the ones that you do. If only there was some magic technology that could help you. For those of you who don't know me, hi, my name is Mark. This is kind of my area. So I've been coming here for years trying to push this idea that machine learning, AI, is a technology worth investing in. It's worth taking advantage of. And when I started, it was really kind of a nascent, dark art. So it's come a long way in those years. And right now, the availability of being able to get some of these tools on your system is pretty wide. You have big companies like Microsoft, IBM, Google, Amazon, all providing these APIs for you, pretty low cost, they're scalable, pretty easy to use. There's absolutely no reason not to. And the value here is that what machine learning does is it does this heavy lifting for you. It's like a bionic suit. You have a ton of data out there. You can't go and read it all. You can't analyze it all. Machine learning can. It'll crunch it down, give you insights, and give you that power that you need. And the important thing is, this is, again, I've got more data here. Across the board, experience marketing budgets haven't been going up. So you have to still do all the work that you have and that you're just growing with the same team. How are you going to do that? As you add more content, as hopefully you're using personalization, you're adding more rules, you're doing more things, this requires some level of maintenance. How are you going to scale up? And the tools that we have here is going to help you do that. Another piece of information I dug out is that 91% of tech executives will agree that AI is the next tech revolution. This is valuable because that means leadership is bought into this idea. It's no longer you maybe ringing the bell. Leadership knows now. The case should be a lot easier to make. Maybe they're not giving you the budget because, you know, previously they just didn't believe, but now they do. The tools are there. The data is here. We know it works. We know it's valuable. Another survey found most effective digital marketing technique according to marketers worldwide. 9% mobile marketing, marketing automation. 10% social media marketing, significant chunk of people. 20% content marketing, Sitecore CMS. 28%, pretty significant chunk. So the AI, big data, is the one that's moving the needle for them. Now, Sitecore does have machine learning, and as they announced in the keynote, they have Sitecore AI. Sitecore AI is going to be a, as far as I understand, a cloud PaaS thing. But the stuff that you have, if you have just any other system, it kind of works after you've got this data in your system. You've already set up personalization, you've had people using it, all that data goes next to B and gets crunched up, tries to help you improve with your rules, help you do some tagging. But that's kind of working at the end. And that's what Sitecore's working on. What I'm working on is a little different. I'm trying to get ahead of it. What I want to do is get you into the personalization game so that there is data, so that machine learning then works for you. And this is where we get to see the magic. Okay, so imagine for a moment, I'm a business owner, I'm also a parent. I have a beautiful young daughter, she's energetic. If I don't take her out of the house, she'll tear my house apart. helped me and my friends and other people who are parents find things for their children to do. It's a website called Fun Stuff for Kids. It has events, things that you can do. I had a partner who helped me set it up. They did some personalization for me. Some of it just helps people who are interested, tries to push them into registering and signing up. Anybody who signed up then is looking for tickets, helps them buy tickets. But there's a whole community that doesn't have any personalization around this at all. This is kind of new. People are sharing things. I built this, I wanted to help get people connected. I need personalization for that too. I don't know exactly what they did to set it up. I'm a little confused. I do know a little bit. I know down here in the marketing control panel, there's a lot of things that I can do. There's goals, campaigns, app analyzer, there's profiles. I drill in a little bit, I can see what they did set up. I'm not entirely sure I know the differences between a profile card and a profile card persona, but I do kind of know like some of it. Did a little research, but I've been waiting, I've been holding off, because necessary. I know it takes a little bit of learning. I've been waiting until I had that time to do it, and I just never seemed to get that time. But my partner was very kind, and they installed this thing called Ola. Ola. It's Ola is actually a name of one of the early founders of Sitecore. It's a Danish name. But it's a chatbot in the system. The spirit moving on. And if I open it up, it can talk to me, and I can ask it things. And I remember they said that I could help me set up personalization. For those of you who don't know, this is actually something I built. This is not Sitecore. If you have any questions, please come to me. But this chatbot is going to help me set this up. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask it, how do I set up Sitecore personalization? And it's going to give me a list. That's a few things. This is not a comprehensive product, doesn't do everything. It's like, where's a vast product, and I can only do so much. But it gives me a few things. The first four are really around profiles. So I can set profiles, score content, and create some goals. Basic things, getting started, just getting into the game. So the first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna create a profile. What do I wanna call it? So this is, I'm trying to target some social thing, so I'm just gonna call it social. What are the keys, categories? Okay, right, so in social, what are the things that I'm trying to track? So I'm gonna do reading, sharing, and contributing to my social area of my website. So I'm setting up a profile with three distinct kind of sub-profiles. Now I can click on any one of these here, I can change the name, it will re-offer me that option, or I can hit confirm. I've created a profile. The next thing is it's actually publishing it for me too. I don't have to worry about that. It's all done for me. I don't remember everything that I was trying to do. So I'm gonna go back to my menu. And I'm gonna create a pattern card, that's right. Pattern card, what is a pattern card? Something about traffic patterns. So the pattern I want, the profile I want to use is a social one I just created. What is the target audience? What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to find people who are coming to my community page and I want to push them to share it on social media. So I want to find people who are reading. That's my target audience. That's going to go through my keys on my profile. For contributing, I don't really care for anything there. I'm just going to hit zero. For reading, I want to find the people who get 10 points worth of reading. That's what I care about. Sharing, zero as well. So what I'm saying here is that when we have a traffic pattern of people who have got at least 10 points for reading, I want to know about that. I'm going to write a rule against that later. So I'm going to hit confirm. Create a pattern for that. Okay, great. So I'm going to go back. I'm going to create a profile card. That's right. That's what's next. Again, I'm going to select my social profile. The name of the profile cards. The profile cards are all about story. So I want to give points to content. So I want to give points to people who read. Similar name to the other. Contributing, I'm not giving any points. Reading, I would give less so that you have to read it a few times to add up to 10. But for this example, I'm just giving a 10. For sharing, I'm going to give 0. Then I'm going to hit confirm. Okay? my school content, typically in Sitecore, I have to go through, pick a page, push the button, go through the menu, select what I want, maybe I customize it. But while, again, my coworker was kind enough to be here with you, mentioned that doing that takes a long time and you have a lot of content. So what I try to do is, instead of making you do it manually every one item, I'm doing a search. But what it's going to ask me for is information about how it's going to do its search. Do I want to select by name? In this case, I do. So I want to look for my parent community page to give it points. So if people read my parent community enough, I want to know about it. Do I want to select by template? In this case, I don't, but I could. I can select by folder, maybe everything under a certain area entry, by field value. Okay, so here I am. I can review my choices. I can go back and change it. But in this case, I'm just going to say confirm. It's gone its data search. It's applied my scoring to it, and it's done. It hasn't published it like the others because these are pages. I want to do that myself. Maybe there's workflow. But it's going to attach that content for me. Now, the last things I want to do is around goals. This much I can remember. So when I create a goal, number one, I want to call it social sharing, because that's what I'm trying to drive people into doing. How many points do I want to give? 5. Confirm. Done. Attach goal to a page. Pick my goal, social sharing. Or page. It's also known as social sharing. And I'm going to confirm. Okay, seemed easy enough. I'm not really sure if all things happened like I thought they would, so I'm gonna check. I'm gonna open up my goals. Sure enough, my social sharing is there. My points are there. I'm gonna refresh my profiles. I have a social profile now. My keys are there, my profile card, my banner cards. All right, so far so good. I'm gonna go to my content stream, I'm gonna check my community page. Content is scored, my reading. Here on my social page, I'm gonna go to my goals. That's gonna add it. So now, all I have to do is go into my page, my home page, and I'm gonna add some content to personalize. So what I'm trying to do is drive people who have been reading my community page to try to want to share on social media. And I'm going to personalize. I'm going to hide this by default. Add a rule for patterns. I'm going to pick my social profile. My reading profile card, my pattern card. And I'm going to pick the content to show. Easy enough. Now I'm going to save, publish. I'm going to publish all my sub items, so all the scores that I added and the goals they published as well. All right, I'm done. Now, I don't know how long it's been, a couple minutes, but I've created profiles, ad cards, or content, goals, attached that. I didn't feel as painful as I thought it would. It didn't take weeks of reading than I thought it might. So let's try it out, make sure that it works. I'm going to go to fun stuff with kids, like an audience, anybody that would come to my site, generally. Look at some events. Head of the Charles McDonald, like I said, I'm awesome. Okay, that's great. What I'm looking for, I'm going to go to the search page, though. I don't want to click through everyone. So the other thing is, if you can kind of tell, the search isn't going to behave like a normal search. I'm going to ask it something more specific. It's not a single word search. This is actually a natural language search. And I can go and I can filter down. I can click into things. I can find what I'm looking for. Some ball musicals are happening. But the most interesting thing is that even if I take this and I switch around, still works. It knows that I'm looking for an event, and it knows that there are information about ages and ticket prices and locations, and it's going to try to find them. And if it does, it's going to filter my search down. And it just makes it a little bit easier instead of having all those facet lists and refreshers, all those things that you have to do. It makes it easier to be able to just say what I want to say. And the interesting thing is, so it's triggering some of my personalization from before. So it knows that I've been reading some articles, I've been searching and interested. Hey, it's time to become a member. And I want to, I am interested. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click OK. And now my search form is actually converted to a conversation form. And what it's going to do is try to register me through this form all in one place. So I'm going to put in my email. This is not my email. And I'm going to put in my password. Also not my password. That's it. I'm done. And the interesting thing about that is that in that process, if I get anywhere and I don't put in the right email, it's going to tell me right away. I don't have to fill out a long form, get to the bottom, then I'm trying to find out I missed three fields every month. And I can do one at a time. And every single time I'm storing that value, I'm not all or nothing with like a regular form, I'm catching it as it comes in. And I can continue to add that to people's profiles and personalize things on just the little information I was able to glean from that conversation. But I did it. I'm a member now. I'm in. Great. So now I'm going to go back and I'm going to look for events in Boston for kids age 3. Here I am. And you know what? I'm looking for tickets though. I've been reading for a while. I'm interested. I want tickets for it. And I'm getting personalization. So the interesting thing here is that now it's telling me buy now and save big. Okay. I'm going to go and get these tickets. It knows the difference between me trying to do a search and me trying to search for tickets. There's a conversational difference. And there's a whole separate part of my website that is for purchasing things versus looking things up. And if you know me, Marshmallow Fluff Festival, that's what I'm going to do. So you can imagine there's an entire commerce part. I didn't think that setting that up would be necessarily helpful for this demo, but you can imagine that there would be some kind of process here. And then here I get to this, there's a goal triggered on that. All right, great. So now, so far, I've been looking around, I've been interested, I've been pushed into membership, I've bought tickets. I'm in, I've been here for a while, I'm really part of this, I like it. I've been looking around, now I'm gonna explore more. I'm gonna look into this community. And then I'm gonna go to my homepage. And what's happening now is my homepage is personalized. And this is the stuff that I just set up. Do I love this site? Let all my friends know. Okay, I'm going to do that. I have been here. I am interested. Now I'm going to go to social media and tell my friends about it because I want them to come with me. Now, I've done all of this. I've kind of made the same personalization that my partner helped me set up. I've done this myself, and it wasn't that hard. And now I'm in the game. Now, the most important part is that when I go back and I go to my experience analytics, data is showing up. And now I can make decisions. Now I can make changes that improve the outcome for my audience and for me and my business. And that's what really matters here, is that until you're really getting that data, you're not able to really make the decisions. You're just hoping things work. But if you can get it set up, if you can get in there without too much friction and get it working, you can do so much more. So that is the end of that. And we'll jump back into this. So, what did we just see? So on one hand, we saw this idea of chat-assisted authoring. So Sitecore, and I love Sitecore, I'm always promoting it, but there is a lot to do. There is a lot of different places, a lot of applications. You have to jump around, it takes a lot of time to load sometimes. It can be a little bit time-consuming. So what I'm trying to do is shorten that and put it kind of all in one place and make it more of a simplified task for you. So you can chat your way through. And what this means is that you're more effective. Your time is spent less time spending setting up Sitecore and more time using Sitecore. More time getting benefit from all the tools that they provide. And more importantly, you can work on the go. One thing I didn't show you, but I will, is that the chatbot is basically a native mobile interface. You can text to the system. You can log in, go to the launch pad, there's a button there, and you can open it up on your phone and you can still be working. How many people here on the way here had to break out their laptop to do some work? Yes, how many people would much rather just put their phone on and do that? Right? And now you can. And the other thing is that you can build a custom experience for your business. So what I've shown you is just a bit of simple things that I've put together, but if you have a PIM or CRM, or maybe some combination of data, then you want to put together a report and have a link, you can do that. You can have it in just a nice conversational interface. You want to ask it in a certain way, you can do that. And then you can jump off to whatever it is you need. On the other half, we were looking at a natural language search. And what that is that it's taking your phrase, it's allowing you to ask all these questions, pulling the parts, and trying to figure out what you're trying to do. In this case, I was doing an event search, pulling out locations and age ranges, and then it's filtering that search. But the cool thing about this is it opens up this whole new opportunity for you to be able to have a conversation with your audience. A two-way conversation. You're not just talking to people anymore, you're listening. And it's nice because you can start to figure out what they want more when they ask more. You can write rules. The tickets rule that I wrote is just about when people search for the word tickets, give them a link to the tickets page. When you ask, when you expect that they'll ask for more for most things, you can write better rules for those things. And the best thing about it is that on stage of the keynote, they bring up the perfect data point for this. 42% of companies don't listen to their customers. I couldn't have thought of like a better thing to really prove this out. And honestly, it's on the one hand, it's a little sad. On the other hand, I thought the number was higher, so that's good. But the opportunity for you to really listen to your audience is profound here with this tool. So what I'm doing is I'm saying that there's registration, there's some contact form, there's event search. These are things I know about. The people ask for them, I'm going to say, I know what they're trying to do. I'm going to solve that problem for you. But if I don't know what they're asking for, it falls into kind of this bucket. And that bucket I can go through and I can say, a lot of people are asking for this. I'm going to add a new silo here. I'm going to answer that problem for them. I'm listening to them. I'm watching. I'm monitoring when changes happen to my website and my audience. And I can react. I can pivot. I can grow with them. I can build institutional value for my business over the long term. And that's what this is really changing. Now, a lot of this technology that you saw, the kind of new idea of building a chatbot and natural language search, is really built on the same technology. And there's only two APIs really driving this whole thing. Number one, spell check. I'm just trying to fix any error corrections as people are saying things before I send it off. And then on the other half is Lewis, which just figures out which thing they're trying to do and pull out any meaningful data. But that's really all it is. Just these two things. You go to Azure, you push a button, and you get a key. And you have to do a little bit of, if you want to add some new things to Lewis, you have to do it, type in some phrases or whatever, you push train and publish. But that's really it. It's more you're in the domain that you're expected to be in of language, of how people ask things and say things, than technology. So this is a really powerful tool. It's Microsoft, it's scalable, it's pretty cheap for the amount of back and forth you can use it for free. I highly recommend it. And this is the kind of magic moment. You can check out the secure code and you can go to the URL, but you can actually try this out right now. I put a server up there, you can go in and punch in your email, creates a user and it logs you in, and you can try Ola. And you can give it a shot. I mean, it doesn't do everything, please don't try to do everything, but it does a few things, right? It publishes content, it creates goals and profiles, it can rebuild an index, it can get users, it can unlock your ideas. It's a good start, and we can add more. We can customize it, add more value. Most importantly, this is a completely new paradigm for you to be able to work on a phone. Again, I love Sitecore. I've tried to log in, I had to log in on my phone to get things done, and it's just not that easy. And I'm not thinking, please don't give me a look in the back here. But I'm really happy to try to solve this problem. It's just a new way to think of like how do you cycle all together. So I'll leave it up there. If you're like me, my phone takes forever. Okay, so if you want to get your hands on this and you want to use it, maybe I've hopefully made the case for you. There's blog articles out there that describes how to set it up, how to use it, how to extend it. There are videos to kind of walk through, give you more of an informational idea of what it does. There's actually 5 different things that I built. 2 of which you saw, which is the natural language search and the chatbot. There are 3 more. You can come by our booth, check out the demo, I have it running. If you have a partner, they can do it for you. If you don't, you can talk to me later. But this stuff is out there, it's free. Please use it. There's so many new things that you can do. There's an image search. We can change the media library, how it works. We can analyze all your images, we know where faces are, and colors, and all this other stuff. I can help you find and sort your media library. We can tag content, automate the content tagging. We can do, this is kind of a new one, but I can take a page and I can turn it into an MP3. You can go and you can listen to your content. Completely open up the avenue for your audience. So I'm going to leave you with this. Through this whole talk, I've been trying to build this theme about the power of language. From the content authoring chatbot to the natural language search, language is really the tie that binds. And I can think of no better thing than language to make human connections in the digital world. Thank you very much, everyone. Have a nice week.
So if you want to play around with Ola, would we be able to copy your rules from your Lewis to another Microsoft account to our own Azure account?
Yes.
Are
you should definitely have your own account.
Yeah.
So it's fine. No. So you go to Azure and you have your account. You create a Lewis plot.
Yes.
Gives you a key. You go into the content tree. There's a list of API connectors, Microsoft as well. You know, when you paste them into the field, it's
there. Yeah, but the rules that you have for Ola, basically.
Yeah, so the training data is on the, under that, there's an Ola node, and one of the fields has all the JSON where you just train it. Ready? Trying to think of this now. I actually automated it too, so you could hit the button and it would upload it automatically.
Okay.
I think they may have changed some APIs, so you may have to do it manually, but. Yes. Anyone else? I also have stickers for anyone who's interested.
So when you say not expensive, what do you mean? To give an example?
Yeah, I've been using it for like 2 years, 3 years. And if I get like 10,000 hits a month for free, I think it's like $1 per like 1,000 or 10,000 or something like that. It's cheap, yeah. Like you can, and for content authoring, it's not like you're hitting it 10,000 times a month, right? So on that end, you can probably get away entirely free.
Could you set a cap?
You can put, I think, some kind of in Azure, like you have your so much money a month and then hit that, yeah. Yeah. Anyone having good jokes?